jobs from low-income minorities and abusing public benefit programs, setting people against each other. More alarmingly, Senator Sessions voted at least twice against the DREAM Act, which seeks to protect some of our country's most vulnerable youth, undocumented individuals, children who were brought here through no choice of their own. On President Obama's executive action to protect children, known as DACA, he doesn't just oppose it, he's actively seeking to take it down. A recent Washington Post article says he's lobbying for the administration to overturn DACA. It's one thing to disagree on policy, but it's quite another when the policy could crush the lives of ordinary people. In December, I wrote an op-ed in the San Francisco Chronicle about the importance of DACA and what it means for Californians. I discussed the story of Denise Rojas, brought to the United States as a 10-month-old baby. Rojas's family is similar to families with mixed status. Her mother and father came to the United States to create a better life for their children. Denise excelled in high school and majored in biology at UC Berkeley. She worked as a waitress and commuted an hour each way to classes because she couldn't afford to live near campus. After graduation, she volunteered at San Francisco General Hospital. Denise dreamed of going to medical school, driven in part by a family member's early death from cancer. The disease was diagnosed at a late stage because the family's immigration status made it impossible to afford health insurance. Today, Rojas is enrolled in New York's Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai, where she's on track to earn her degree in 2019. She intends to specialize in emergency medicine and work in low-income communities to provide health care to families like her own who would otherwise go without necessary treatment. This is the perfect case for discretion. This is the perfect case for the exercise of a just humanity. But Senator Sessions is lobbying to overturn DACA. The consequences of such a draconian and inhumane action would be devastating to thousands of people in my state. And I find it deeply disturbing that Senator Sessions would advocate for the deportation of children who have known no other country but the United States. And if he doesn't believe these youth deserve some sort of prosecutorial discretion when it comes to deportation, how's he going to act as our nation's leading federal criminal prosecutor? It's no secret that he believes in an aggressive use of executive enforcement in the power of immigration. He testified in response to Senator Flake that he favors, quote, a zero-tolerance policy for immigration crimes. Immigration offenses already make up about a third of all federal prosecutions each year. So does it make sense to increase that substantially? There certainly are more troubling crimes at the border and across the country that require the attention and resources of the Department of Justice. Human trafficking, smugglers, organized crime, gangs, drug trafficking, hate crimes, white-collar crimes, civil rights, voting rights, just to name a few. So Senator Sessions' opposition to prosecutorial discretion caused me great concern. Let's move on to criminal law. During the hearing, discussing sentencing with Senator Coons, Senator Sessions revealed his view about what a federal prosecutor should be. He said it was, quote, a problematic thing that is difficult to justify when a prosecutor uses some discretion to bring lesser charges or not to charge the maximum drug charge available. Now, as we know, drug prosecutions were the most common federal charge in 2015. So Senator Sessions' view on them will have a big impact on the workload in U.S. attorneys' offices. If it becomes nationwide policy of the department, it will mean mandatory sentences of 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, and even life in prison for drug charges imposed much more often. Because depending on how prosecutors charge cases, the laws will tie judges' hands when it comes to a sentence. And that's how our system works today. The mission of a prosecutor is to do justice, not instinctively bring the maximum charge. Then Attorney General Robert Jackson said in 1940, "The prosecutor has more control over life, liberty, and reputation than any other person in America. His discretion is tremendous." Quote, "Your positions are of such independence and importance that while you are being diligent, strict, and vigorous in law enforcement, you can also afford to be just. Although the government technically loses its case, it has really won if justice has been done." For Senator Sessions to say that a prosecutor cannot exercise some judgment based on the circumstances of a case to seek a lesser charge or a lesser punishment, in my view, is just not correct. We have discussed mandatory minimum sentencing in the Judiciary Committee. The senator from Illinois, distinguished as he is, has been a leader in this cause. It's been discussed for years in the context of the sentencing reform efforts led by Senators Lee, Cornyn, Durbin, Grassley, Leahy, and Whitehouse. Senator Lee, in particular, has been a passionate advocate against mandatory minimum sentence. I believe in enforcement of the drug laws. I always have. These are difficult questions about what actions the Justice Department would take in states that have legalized marijuana in some way or another under their own laws. But the bottom line is this: sensitivity and good judgment are needed in prosecutorial decisions. We want to make sure the sentence fits the crime and that resources are used wisely. Senator Sessions' comments make it clear that he generally opposes granting discretion to a prosecutor to impose a lesser charge or a lesser sentence based on the circumstances of the case before them. One thing I found striking was that Senator Sessions' written statement to the committee, he said the following: "I understand the demands for justice and fairness made by the LGBT community. Now, I have served on the Judiciary Committee for 24 years. 20 of them have been alongside Senator Sessions. I cannot recall a single time when he spoke about supporting any kind of justice and fairness for the LGBT community or made any kind of statement like this. And we looked and couldn't find one in the congressional record either. In fact, the statement stands at odds with his record. And let me give you a few examples. In 2011, we marked up a bill I had introduced to repeal the Defense of Marriage Act, known as DOMA, that denied married gay and lesbian couples equal protection under the law. Not only did Senator Sessions vote no, as all Republicans on the committee did, but he asked questions like, "What about two sisters?" as if to compare same-sex marriage to incest, a demeaning statement about hundreds of thousands of families in this country. He voted against allowing gay and lesbian Americans to serve in the military. In 2009, he voted against the Matthew Shepard and James Byrd Hate Crimes Act. He said he just did not see the kind of discrimination happening against the LGBT community or women. And he said the law was potentially unconstitutional, which is not an argument that, to my knowledge, has ever been accepted by a court. In 2006, he voted to enshrine discrimination in our Constitution by supporting a constitutional amendment to ban same-sex marriage everywhere in the country. What did he say? He said the Senate had to debate the amendment because of, quote, a deliberate and sustained effort by leftists in America, social activists, and activist judges. He talked about harm to children, ignoring the fact that same-sex couples are, in fact, raising children, and that denying equal legal recognition to their families actually hurts those children. Then he went on to criticize the 2003 decision of the Supreme Court in Lawrence v. Texas, which essentially said that private homosexual conduct cannot be made a crime in this nation. The Lawrence decision, written by Justice Anthony Kennedy, was a victory for freedom. How did Senator Sessions describe it? He argued the decision was wrong and, quote, troubling with far-reaching ramifications, end quote. He said it was a, quote, new vision of social justice masquerading as constitutional law, end quote. He called Justice Scalia's dissent, quote, brilliant. That dissent, by the way, accused the Supreme Court of, quote, signing on to the so-called homosexual agenda, by which I mean the agenda promoted by some homosexual activists directed at eliminating the moral opprobrium that is traditionally attached to homosexual conduct, end quote. And when he was Attorney General of Alabama, he sought to shut down a conference of LGBT students on a public university campus in Alabama. This was despite a Supreme Court decision issued just a year earlier protecting a Christian student group from discrimination based on viewpoint. The 11th Circuit Court, in a panel of three judges appointed all by Republican presidents, called the state's action, quote, blatant viewpoint discrimination, and characterized Sessions' arguments as, quote, feeble. Does any of this sound like the actions of a person who understands the demands for justice and fairness made by the LGBT community? My answer is no. And how will that impact the Attorney General? Mr. President, the Attorney General must enforce federal hate crimes laws. The Attorney General must ensure that federal law treats same-sex couples equally, that the right to marry and be treated equally under federal law is recognized and protected. Here we are, Mr. President, I think at a very difficult and dangerous turning point. We have a president with little apparent regard for constitutional or legal restrictions, and who is willing to take to Twitter to target and abuse individuals and groups of Americans, and even belittle and demean federal judges and the federal court system, just as he did during the campaign. We have a president who's taken a shock and awe approach with cruel, un-American, and potentially illegal executive orders, even in his first 2 weeks in office, which this nominee reportedly urged be done even faster. We have a president who wants to bring back torture, even though, thanks to Senator McCain, Congress has already stated that it is clearly illegal. And we have a president who's already angering long-term allies like Australia and making ridiculous threats of sending troops to Mexico. And we have a nominee for Attorney General who is anything but independent. He was part and parcel of the Trump campaign apparatus, transition, agenda, and way of thinking. As Steve Bannon wrote in the Washington Post just days ago, Sessions was, and I quote, the fiercest, most dedicated, and most loyal promoter in Congress of Trump's agenda, and has played a critical role as the clearinghouse for policy and philosophy to undergird the implementation of that agenda. Do any of my colleagues, Republican or Democrat, think Steve Bannon didn't know what he was talking about in this email to the Washington Post? Do any of my colleagues believe that if Senator Sessions is confirmed, he's going to take off the political hat and be an even-handed attorney general for all Americans who will tell this president no when it's merited on the basis of the law and the Constitution. I just don't believe it for a second. So I must vote no and urge my colleagues to do the same. Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the floor.
President.
Senator from South Carolina.
Thank you. Mr. President, I rise in support of the nomination of Senator Sessions to be Attorney General of the United States, and let me make a few comments about the process. I would expect that the Attorney General nominee know the President well before they're chosen. This idea that Senator Sessions was close to President Trump during the campaign is somehow a disqualifier makes absolutely zero sense to me. The bottom line is, that's exactly the kind of people you would expect a president to pick. Someone who has been on their team, someone they know, someone they believe in to carry out the duties of the office that they're nominated for. So I don't have the time to go through history, but I would assume that in past nominations, particularly for Attorney General, there's been some kind of relationship between the president who nominated and the person who's seeking the job. So if that's going to be the new standard, I would suggest that nobody in this body ever endorse anybody for president, because apparently you can't serve in the cabinet. That would be kind of silly. I look at this as, are you qualified for the job? Our friends on the other side look at it as, if you don't agree with their liberal agenda, you can't do the job. Big difference. There's been an absolute wholesale attack on everything Trump when it comes to the nominations, with a few exceptions. And the basis of the attack is that they don't share the worldview of our friends on the other side. That worldview was litigated pretty thoroughly, and you lost. What do you expect Donald Trump to do after his campaign? I expect him to do what he said he was going to do. Some of it I agree with it, some of it I don't. And where I don't agree with him, I will challenge him. But the one challenge I will not make against this president is to deny him the ability to pick somebody that is clearly, in my view, qualified, even though I may have differences with them on particular issues. I would say this about Senator Sessions. I've known him for 20 years almost. I've traveled throughout the world with Senator Sessions and his family. Most of the time I agree with Jeff Sessions, sometimes I don't, but I found him to be an incredibly honorable man, worthy of the job of being United States Senator from the great state of Alabama, reflecting the values of the people of Alabama. That's what he got elected to do, by the way. And I think he'll be uniquely qualified to be the Attorney General of the United States at a time of great challenge. He's been a U.S. attorney. He's been Attorney General of his state. He's a man steeped in the law. His biggest crime, I think, is that he's very conservative. That, to me, is not a disqualifier any more than being very liberal is a disqualifier. How do you think we felt when Barack Obama basically turned Obamacare upside down with one executive order after another? Every time it started stinking up in public, he would unilaterally change the law to avoid a political consequence, or granting millions of people legal status with a stroke of a pen well beyond his lane, struck down by court as being outside his ability as president to do. And not once did anybody on that side raise an objection. Eric Holder's a fine man. I can't remember a time when Eric Holder stood up to this runaway train in the Obama administration. Loretta Lynch is a fine woman. I can't remember one time she expressed doubt about President Obama's agenda when it's left up to the courts to express doubt, and this election, believe it or not, was a lot to do with the way the last 8 years has rolled out. This was a check and balance election, and you're not going to be able to undo the consequences of this election unfairly. And I think it would be unfair to say that Senator Jeff Sessions is not qualified for the job at hand. Most of the attacks against Senator Sessions could be levied against almost everybody on this side of the aisle. The NAACP, according to Jeff Sessions, is one of the premier civil rights organizations in the history of the country, and I think that is a fair characterization. Mr. Cornell Brooks, CEO of the NAACP, said of Senator Sessions, "Senator Sessions' record throughout his career, whether in this office, whether in the office of the U.S. Attorney for the Southern District of Alabama, as Attorney General of the State of Alabama, or most recently as the junior U.S. Senator from Alabama, evinces a clear disregard, disrespect, and even disdain for the civil and human rights of racial and ethnic minorities, women, the disabled, and others who suffer from discrimination in this country, a damning indictment." Apparently, he doesn't stay in contact with the NAACP chapter in Alabama. Because in 2009, the NAACP gave Jeff Sessions Civic and Human Rights Convention, April 23rd to 26th, 2009, NAACP Governmental Award of Excellence, Senator Jeff Sessions, for the outstanding work you do. That's one of the awards he forgot to tell us about, so I hope he will amend. Another attack on Senator Sessions, he received an award from a David Horowitz group who was labeled by Senator from Connecticut as being some right-wing extremist organization. All I can say is the Annie Taylor Award is named for a lady who went over Niagara Falls in a barrel. They give it to conservatives who stood up under difficult circumstances. I actually received the award as an impeachment manager. Chris Matthews was there to moderate the dinner. So I don't know what Mr. Horowitz has said after I was there, before he was there. All I can say is that I received the award too, and I sure as hell don't consider myself a bigot. Voting against the Violence Against Women Act authored by Senator Leahy. I won't give you a long rendition. I voted against it too, for reasons I'll be glad to explain to you at a later time. The bottom line here is that most of the things said about Jeff Sessions and the way he acted as a senator could be said about almost all of us on this side who consider themselves conservative. Back to our friends at the NAACP. I asked Mr. Brooks, "Do you have a legislative scorecard, how you rate people in the body?" And he said yes, and Senator Sessions has been historically low rated. Here's what I want the body to know, that in the report card of the 113th Congress, the first half, here are the ratings. Senator Grassley, all Republicans here, 11%, Hatch 25%, Graham 25%, Cornyn 11%, Lee 11%, Cruz 11%, Sass, not, he wasn't in the Congress, Flake 29%, Crapo 14%, Tillis and Kennedy were not rated yet. On the Democratic side of the Judiciary Committee, Feinstein 100%, Leahy 100%, Whitehouse 100%, Klobuchar 100%, Franken 100%, Coons 96%, Blumenthal 100%, Hirano 100%. Not only did Jeff Sessions have a poor rating, all of us did. So to my friends on the other side, you're making arguments that I don't think are good for the future of this body and the country as a whole. You're basically saying you did not vote for the legislation I supported. You voted against ideas I embrace that I think make America a unique place. Therefore, you cannot have this job. Here's what I would say. Senator Sessions voted as a very conservative senator from the state of Alabama, who has conducted himself honorably his entire life. And I really regret that we've gotten to this point. All of us in here know Jeff. And I have been on this floor fighting with him tooth and nail about immigration reform. I've worked with Senator Durbin, who's going to speak next. And our chief antagonist most of the time was Senator Sessions. Never in my darkest day did I ever believe that Jeff Sessions said one word on this floor that he did not truly believe. And he reflects the views of millions of Americans. As to the status of the LGBT community, I think Jeff Sessions was representing the values of his state. And all I can say is that that's what we're set up here to do. And if we disagree, we disagree. But it's a big leap from policy disagreement to not qualified. And I asked the NAACP chairman, name one Republican you would recommend to be Attorney General. I've yet to get a name. So what we're talking about here, unfortunately, is an attack on conservatism more than it is Jeff Sessions. Because almost everything said about Jeff could be said about me and most of my colleagues over here. Why did I vote for Holder? Why did I vote for Lynch? Why did I vote for Sotomayor and Kagan? And the list goes on and on and on. I expect that when a liberal president wins, that they will pick people who are qualified, who share their view, to represent their administration. When it comes to the Attorney General, you can be liberal and you can be conservative, but you still also can be fair to the public as a whole. I don't believe for one second that Jeff Sessions, as Attorney General of the United States, will take any of his political positions and jam them down your throat if the law says no. I've never seen that about the man. And the minority leader of the Alabama Senate, Senator Ross, African-American Democratic minority leader, said, "I have worked with Jeff Sessions. I know him personally, and all of my encounters with him have been for the greater good of Alabama. We've spoken about everything from civil rights to race relations. We agree that as Christian men, our hearts and minds are focused on doing right by all people." That is the Jeff Sessions that I know. That is why I lend my support to his nomination. I have some serious differences with President Trump, and those differences will materialize over time, and I hope I have the courage of my convictions to stand up for what I believe, even when my party has the White House. That's a very hard thing to do for all of us. I intend to do it to the best of my ability, and I will get a lot of coverage for doing that, because that makes for good political reporting. But what will not be covered is the fact that on the really big issues, mostly, I agree with President Trump and Jeff Sessions about what we need to do to change the dynamic regarding crime. I will work with Senator Durbin to bring about sentencing reform, but it is now time to go in on the offense against crime. And one of the things that pleases me most about this nomination of Senator Sessions is that we have been very strong allies in fighting the war on terror. That Jeff Sessions understands the difference between fighting a crime and fighting a war. That it will be welcome news for me to have an Attorney General who understands that bin Laden's son-in-law, who's captured on the battlefield, should be treated differently than somebody tried to steal your car. That under Jeff Sessions, the Justice Department will look at enemy combatants for who they are, warriors in a cause to destroy our life, and they will be held consistent with the law of war, not domestic criminal law. In the days of terrorists being read the Miranda rights as if they were a common criminal will soon be over. That will make us all safer. So I look forward to voting for Senator Sessions, working with him, and if we have disagreements, the one thing I know for sure that Jeff will at least listen to me. This body is adrift. The country is really divided. I hope that once this confirmation process is over, that we can get back to doing the business of the American people. And to the extent that Donald Trump becomes the problem, we will push back. Right now, people are pushing back against everything all the time. And you're going to hurt yourself as well as this body. Because there is no way you can ever convince me that Jeff Sessions is not qualified to be the Attorney General. I can understand why you wouldn't pick him. There's no doubt in my mind that he's somebody a Republican conservative president would pick, and they did. I yield the floor.
Mr. President.
Assistant Minority Leader.
Mr. President, let me say at the outset that I'm glad I was here for the statement made by the senator from South Carolina. We disagree on many things, but we agree on things as well. I respect him very much and turn to him often to find bipartisan support when, frankly, no one else would answer the phone. And he has been a great friend and ally and has been very blunt with me when we disagreed. We do disagree today, and I do it respectfully because Senator Graham is a person I do, in fact, respect as a Senate colleague. He's right about one thing. You would expect a new president to pick someone to be an attorney general whom they know and trust. It might have even been someone from the campaign trail. The classic example of 1960 when President John Kennedy was elected and chose his brother, Robert Kennedy, who'd worked in his campaign to serve as Attorney General of the United States. You can't think of a clearer analogy to what has been described today. But the point that was made earlier by Senator Feinstein about the relationship of Senator Sessions with candidate Trump is one that goes beyond familiarity and beyond support in a political campaign. In fact, they did work together, and they do agree on some fundamental issues. And if the press can be trusted, and the White House is the first to tell us they can't, but if the press can be trusted, in the Washington Post article of January 31st, 2017, we have a very clear working relationship that extends beyond the would-be Attorney General, Jeff Sessions, the new president, Donald Trump, but includes a former key staffer for Senator Sessions, Steve Miller, and a man named Steve Bannon, who was with Breitbart News and is now a political inspiration to the Trump White House. It appears that they have a very close working relationship among them. That in and of itself is not troubling, except when you look at the issues they've worked on closely together. The issue of immigration, the executive orders. That's a clear example pointed out by this article. And that's one of the reasons it was raised by Senator Feinstein. I understand what Senator Graham has to say, that Senator Sessions has been nothing more than a senator loyal to his home state of Alabama in his politics and in his views on issues. And I do acknowledge that and can tell you that over 20 years I have heard Senator Sessions' speeches repeatedly, and he does take those positions. But the thing that troubles me is the question about whether or not the values of the senator from Alabama are the values we want in the Attorney General of the United States. To be very blunt, in some cases, they're not, as far as I'm concerned. I understand that President Trump won the election, but that doesn't mean when it comes to advice and consent that every member of the Senate has to bow and step back a few steps for every nominee proposed by this new president. We have a responsibility to ask what's right for America, what's right in terms of the values and judgments that we bring to this job as well. It is not a happy moment for me to say this, but I do stand in opposition to the nomination of Jeff Sessions to serve as Attorney General of the United States. The reason I don't view this as a happy moment is I've known him for 20 years, and we've worked in the Senate, in committee, and on the floor. I know him personally. I've met his family. And to say that I don't support him for this elevation to Attorney General is one that is hard to say. But I know that I have to. This is not a decision I've come to lightly. Senator Sessions is a colleague of over 20 years. But the question we now face is whether he is the right person to be the number one law enforcement official in the United States of America. He comes to this new opportunity in a sharply divided nation. We have a controversial new president who already has seen an executive order blocked by the courts in what appears to be record time. Think about that for a moment. Donald Trump has been president of the United States for 19 days. In those 19 days, he has issued an executive order stopped by the federal courts of the land from implementation, and he has dismissed an attorney general. No other new president in 19 days can point to that happening. It's an indication of the types of policies that he's promoting. It's also an indication that in the future, he is likely to again test the separation of powers in this government. In this context, the need for an independent attorney general has never been greater. We need an attorney general who will not just serve as the president's lawyer or cheerleader, but who will defend the constitutional rights of everyone, including protecting those rights from an overreaching president if necessary. As a member of the Judiciary Committee, I've carefully considered this nomination, and I'm not persuaded that Senator Sessions will serve that level of independence. Also, I have strong concerns that if he is confirmed, he won't adequately pursue the cause of justice on a range of important issues. In his nomination hearing, Senator Sessions said on issue after issue, he would simply follow the law, enforce the law. But that doesn't come close to capturing the real role of the Attorney General. The Attorney General, as Chief Prosecutor in America, doesn't just, quote, follow the law. That person uses his discretion to determine how the law is enforced and who it's enforced against. Ignoring that is to ignore one of the key elements of service as Attorney General. As Acting Attorney General Sally Yates reminded us, the Attorney General has a critical role at times in even standing up to the President. The American Bar Association standards say that the duty of the prosecutor is to seek justice, not merely to convict. I don't have confidence, based on the answers he's given me, that Senator Sessions would follow that standard. Here's one example. At the hearing, I introduced Senator Sessions to Alton Mills of Chicago, who in his youth was a street-level courier for drug dealers. He was sentenced to life without parole in prison at age 24. Life without parole at age 24 under the federal three strikes and you're out law. He was sentenced on a nonviolent drug offense. No guns, no violence. He sold drugs a third time and got a life sentence. Even the judge imposing the sentence didn't agree with it, but he said the law said what he had to follow, and his hands were tied. Alton Mills needed to pay for his mistakes, but he didn't need to spend the rest of his life in prison. In December 2015, President Obama commuted Alton's sentence after he had served 22 years in prison. Under the Obama administration, Justice Department prosecutors were directed to search out low-level offenders like Alton Mills and use the discretion of the Department of Justice and make sure that they were given a second chance. Senator Sessions has said he strongly opposes these guidelines. When it came to clemency, Senator Sessions fiercely criticized President Obama, saying he commuted sentences in, quote, quote, an unprecedented, reckless manner, and that, quote, in Senator Sessions' words, so-called low-level nonviolent offenders simply do not exist in the federal system, unquote, Senator Sessions. When it came to changing the law that led to Alton Mills' sentence, Senator Sessions led the opposition. I appreciate the work we did together on the Fair Sentencing Act of 2010, but every time I had returned to Senator Sessions and asked him to work with me for the thousands still stuck in federal prison for nonviolent drug offenses under the old sentencing disparities, which we've now rejected, he refused. time and time again. He has opposed every bipartisan effort, including a bill that I put together with Senator Grassley, Senator Cornyn, and others, to allow individuals to petition on an individual basis for sentence reductions. So to sum it up, Senator Sessions has staunchly opposed using prosecutorial discretion, clemency, or legislation to address the plight of thousands of people like Alton Mills. What can we expect of Attorney General Jeff Sessions in the next 4 years when it comes to criminal justice and criminal sentencing reform? I'm afraid we cannot expect a caring person to take a look at the simple injustice in our system. I have listened time and again, as many other colleagues have, to the statements made by Senator Sessions on the issue of immigration. I've said before on this floor, and I'll say again, I'm a proud son of an immigrant. For generations, America has been renewed and enriched through immigration. Since World War II, we've set an example to the world when it comes to providing a safe haven for refugees. We have four Hispanic senators in this chamber. Three of them are Cuban Americans. What can we say about the Cuban refugees who came to the United States by the hundreds of thousands to flee the oppression of Castro? They were not subjected to extreme vetting. In most cases, we said, if you can find freedom in this country, you are welcome. And they have made America a better nation for it. Since World War II, that has been America's standard. And now it's being challenged. It's hard to understand how the Trump administration could consider spending so much on a Mexican wall. The Texas Republican Congressman Will Hurd, whose district covers 800 miles of the southwest border, described as the most expensive and least effective way to secure the border. I've come to this floor and voted for more money for walls and obstacles and technology on that border than I ever imagined necessary, in the hopes that we could finally put to rest this notion that we can always do more. And I wonder what image it creates of this country as we continue to talk about walls and banning travel. President Obama signed an executive order on January 27, banning immigration from seven Muslim-majority countries and banning refugees from those countries into the United States. As I go through the list of the people who are affected by this, overwhelmingly they're women and children, victims of war, terrorism, and persecution. Many of them have been waiting literally for years to come to the United States. Since World War II, we have accepted so many refugees from Eastern Europe, from Vietnam, from Cuba, as I mentioned earlier, from Yugoslavia. Over 100,000 Soviet Jews make their home in the United States because we accepted them as refugees. Now President Trump has issued this executive order, which is being challenged in court, and we'll know within a matter of days whether it will be stayed or continued, contested, or will stand as law. Attorney General, Acting Attorney General Sally Yates said that she could not stand to defend that order. She felt it was illegal and unconstitutional. The question, obviously, is what would the new Attorney General, if it's Jeff Sessions, do when faced with that same challenge? My fear is that he wouldn't stand an independent judgment of the actions of the president. That, to me, is unfortunate and falls short of what we expect from the Attorney General. We need someone like Edward Levy, the longtime president of the University of Chicago, who served as a truly nonpartisan attorney general under President Ford. He restored honor and integrity to the Justice Department after Watergate. Where would Senator Sessions stand once confirmed? Would he defend the president's executive orders? Would he stand up to the president if he disagreed with him? Mr. President, I see the senator from Arizona is here, and I know that the senator from South Carolina went a little longer than we expected, and we've delayed this, and I don't want to inconvenience him. I'm willing to yield the floor and reclaim it after he's made his remarks.
Mr. President.
Senator from Arizona.
I thank the senator from Illinois for his courtesy, and I think this would take about 7 or 8 minutes, I'd say to my colleague from Illinois. Mr. President, I ask unanimous consent to address the Senate as if in morning business.
Without objection.
Last week, I was heartbroken to learn that a dear friend and great fighter for freedom, Vladimir Kara-Murza, has been hospitalized in Moscow. Those of us who know the work of this brave Russian patriot could not afford to hope or assume that he was suffering some ordinary illness. Just 2 years ago, under mysterious circumstances, Vladimir grew very ill and fell into a coma. Many suspected he was poisoned to intimidate him or worse. That's why last week's news signaled another shadowy strike against a brilliant voice who has defied the tyranny of Putin's Russia. Many Americans are not familiar with the life of Vladimir Kara-Murza, but it's one that reflects the best qualities of leadership, courage, selflessness, idealism, and patriotism. And it's a life dedicated to the principles we all hold dear: truth and justice, freedom and fairness, human rights and human dignity. All his life, Vladimir has been a brave, outspoken, and relentless champion for the Russian people. He's a deputy leader of the People's Freedom Party, Russia's leading pro-democracy party. He's a leading coordinator of Open Russia, a foundation that promotes civil society and democracy in Russia. In 2011, he helped mobilize the largest anti-Kremlin demonstration since the early 1990s, leading tens of thousands of Russians to march in protest of widespread fraud and corruption in the parliamentary elections. In the United States, Vladimir was one of the most passionate and effective advocates for passage of the Magnitsky Act, legislation that gives the federal government powers to punish human rights violators in Russia. Most recently, he has eloquently and persuasively campaigned to expand the act to impose sanctions on those Russian journalists who are so cowed and corrupted by the Kremlin, they become indispensable to propagating the lies and atmosphere of hate, fear, and violence the Putin regime relies on to maintain power. Vladimir's family has a long history of heroism for years dating back to the early 1900s. Vladimir once described the experience of visiting the KGB archives in Moscow, where he reviewed the thin file on his great-grandfather, who was executed, that contained the scant evidence required for a death sentence in Stalin's Russia. He recalled the weight that fell upon him when he read the modest document to which the executioners affixed the date and their signatures to signify that the judgment had been carried out. Vladimir also learned what it takes to be a revolutionary from our mutual friend Boris Nemtsov. Vladimir and Boris struggled together for years in the cause of freedom and democracy. Vladimir once called Boris the best president Russia never had. Boris was one of the first to warn of the incoming Putin dictatorship, even when many of his fellow liberals could not see it. He told the truth about Putin's reign of terror, rampant corruption, and his illegal invasion of Ukraine. And for the crime of telling the truth in Putin's Russia, Boris Nemtsov was murdered in the shadow of the Kremlin in 2015. He died a martyr. He died a martyr. Died a martyr for the rights of people who were taught to hate him, but who will one day mourn his death, revere his memory, and despise his murderers. After Boris's assassination, many urged Vladimir not to return to Russia. And he had every reason not to. He knew his own family's history with tyranny. He knew what happened to Boris Nemtsov, and he knew all too well about the culture of impunity that Putin has created in Russia, where individuals are routinely persecuted and attacked for their beliefs, including by the Russian government, and no one is ever held responsible. He knew about Sergei Yushchenkov, who was investigating the Kremlin's potential role in the 1999 apartment bombings in Russia, when he was shot and killed at the entrance of his apartment. He knew about American journalist Paul Klebnikov, who was investigating Russian government connections to organized crime, when he was shot to death in Moscow in 2004. He knew about Anna Politkovskaya, a journalist, human rights activist, and fierce critic of Putin's brutal war in Chechnya, who was murdered in the stairwell of her apartment building on Putin's birthday in 2006. He knew about former FSB officer Alexander Litvinenko, who exposed Putin's regime's massive corruption tied to organized crime and involvement in assassination and murder and was poisoned to death in 2006 with a radioactive isotope in a brazen act of nuclear terrorism. And he knew about Sergei Magnitsky, that most unlikely of heroes in the cause of freedom, the humble tax attorney who blew the whistle on tax fraud and large-scale theft by Russian government officials, only to be charged with their crimes and die in a squalid cell inside the prison that once held the political opponents of the czars and the Soviets. In short, Vladimir knew that Putin is a killer, and he's a killer, and he might very well be the next target. Vladimir knew that there was no moral equivalence between the United States and Putin's Russia. I repeat, there is no moral equivalent between that butcher and thug and KGB colonel and the United States of America, the country that Ronald Reagan used to call a shining city on a hill. And to allege some kind of moral equivalence between the two is either terribly misinformed or incredibly biased. Neither can be accurate in any way. Knowing all this, knowing that his life was at risk, Vladimir returned to Russia. He continued to speak truth to power. He kept faith with his ideals in confrontation with a cruel and dangerous autocracy. He kept faith, honorably and bravely, with the example of his friend and comrade Boris Nemtsov. Now it appears that Vladimir has once again paid the price for his gallantry and integrity, for placing the interests of the Russian people before his own self-interest. He's very ill. I'm encouraged to learn his condition is now stable. So today, speaking for so many Americans, I offer my most heartfelt prayers for the recovery of Vladimir Kara-Murza and the success of the cause to which he has dedicated his life, truth and justice for the American people. And I do so with the confidence Vladimir himself once expressed. Quote, I am sure that in the end, we will win, because even when dictators prevail for some time, sooner or later, freedom wins. I thank my colleague from Illinois for his indulgence. I yield the floor.
President.
The Assistant Democratic Leader.
Mr. President, I'd like to ask consent that my remarks be resumed and continued from earlier remarks.
Without objection.
Thank you very much. Mr. President, one of the most important issues when it comes to the Attorney General is the oversight of the Civil Rights Division, which is, in fact, the crown jewel of the Justice Department, as far as I'm concerned. It's responsible for protecting the civil rights of all Americans. Senator Cory Booker, Congressman John Lewis, and Cedric Richmond gave powerful testimony at Senator Sessions' hearings. They discussed their concerns about the Justice Department under his leadership and whether it would protect civil and voting rights for Americans. I took their words to heart. I want to talk specifically about their concerns over the Voting Rights Act. 1 month from now, we will recognize the 52nd anniversary of what came to be known as Bloody Sunday, March 7th, 1965. John Lewis, Reverend Hosea Williams, led 600 brave civil rights workers in a march over Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama. The marchers were brutally beaten as state troopers turned them back and chased them down. John Lewis was beaten unconscious and nearly killed. A few months after Bloody Sunday, President Lyndon Johnson signed the Voting Rights Act, guaranteeing the right to vote would not be restricted through clever schemes like poll taxes and literacy tests devised to keep African Americans from voting. In 2006, Congress voted to reauthorize that same act. After 21 hearings, testimony from 90 witnesses, 15,000 pages of testimony. Congressman Lewis said in an op-ed about the ongoing need for that act, Congress came to a near unanimous conclusion. While some changes occurred, the places with a legacy of longstanding, entrenched, and state-sponsored voting discrimination still have the most persistent, flagrant, contemporary records of discrimination in this country. While Senator Sessions ultimately voted to reauthorize the Voting Rights Act, his comments about the law have been troubling. In contrast to Congressman Lewis' statement about the need for a strong Voting Rights Act, Senator Sessions repeatedly criticized the law's Section 5 preclearance provision,
which required certain jurisdictions, including but not limited to Alabama, to pre-clear any changes to their voting laws with the Department of Justice. At his nomination hearing last month, Senator Sessions reiterated his view that Section 5 of the law, in his words, was intrusive. He celebrated the Supreme Court's decision in Shelby County versus Holder, when a divided court, 5-4, gutted the Voting Rights Act and struck down the preclearance provision. That decision left the Department of Justice with fewer tools to protect America's right to vote. Nonetheless, on the day of that awesome and awful decision, Senator Sessions stated, and I quote, "The decision was good news, I think, for the South, in that there was not sufficient evidence to justify treating them disproportionately," end of quote. Senator Sessions was wrong to dismiss the vital role that preclearance has played in protecting voters from discriminatory laws. When Senator Sessions came to my office for a personal meeting before this hearing began, I sat down with him and talked about the Voting Rights Act. I gave to him a book written by Carol Anderson. She's a political science professor at Emory University in the state of Georgia. The book is entitled White Rage. Carol Anderson systematically goes through the history of race in America after the Civil War, and she points out in each section how Congress would, on one hand, give rights to African Americans and then turn around and take them away. The most recent example relates to the Voting Rights Act itself and all the efforts of the 1960s to guarantee that minorities had the right to vote in America. She follows it with the record, undeniable record, of efforts toward voter suppression when it comes to minorities in the United States. I pointed this out to Senator Sessions because he has been in denial over this reality. I told him about hearings that we held in Ohio and Florida, taking election officials, putting them under oath, officials from both political parties, and asking them point blank, before you establish the need for a voter ID in your state, what was the incidence of voter fraud that led you to believe it was necessary? And the answer repeatedly was, there was none. No incidence of voter fraud to speak of, no incidence of anything substantial when it came to prosecution. Clearly, the motive behind these voter suppression laws are just that, to suppress voters from their opportunity to vote. What can we expect of Attorney General Sessions on this issue? I'm afraid, based on his statements, his record, his voting, we can expect the worst. Example, a 3-judge federal appeals court struck down a North Carolina law that required voter IDs and limited early voting. The court found that the law was crafted and passed with racially discriminatory intent in violation of the Constitution and Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act. In the decision, this federal court noted about the North Carolina statute, quote, "Before enacting the law, the legislature requested data on the use by race of a number of voting practices. Upon receipt of the race data, the General Assembly in North Carolina enacted legislation that restricted voting and registration in 5 different ways, all of which disproportionately affected African Americans." Mr. President, we are still facing this challenge in America. I wish it were not the case. I'd hoped at this point in my life I would be pointing to our problems with race as something from the past. But it is the current challenge we face, and it's a challenge which the Attorney General must face squarely. I do not believe that Attorney General Jeff Sessions will do that, and that's why I can't be supporting him for that position. Of course, there's Senator Sessions' decision as U.S. Attorney to bring the 1985 Perry County case when he was in Alabama. He prosecuted 3 African-American civil rights activists for voter fraud. All 3 were acquitted. That case prompted Massachusetts Governor Deval Patrick, who was an attorney for the defendants, to send a letter to members of our committee saying, and I quote, "To use prosecutorial discretion to attempt to criminalize voter assistance is wrong and should be disqualifying for any aspirant to the nation's highest law enforcement post," end of quote. Senator Sessions' statements and his records are particularly concerning in light of President Trump's recent, repeated, baseless claims about voter fraud in the 2016 presidential election. Make no mistake, President Trump's false claim that there were millions of fraudulent votes cast in the last election is an excuse for further voter suppression. It is imperative that the Department of Justice is led by someone who values the vital role that department plays in protecting the right to vote. Given Senator Sessions' dismissive comments about the Voting Rights Act and his history of supporting burdensome voting laws, I am not confident he's prepared to do that. Mr. President, I have several other issues I'd like to raise at this point, but let me ask consent to put them in the record so they're printed in their entirety.
Without objection.
Thank you. And let me conclude. We need a nonpartisan Attorney General with the independence, judgment, and backbone to stand up to a president when his actions are illegal or unjust. Senator Sessions is an able politician. He's been an able representative of his state of Alabama, but he is not the right person to serve as Donald Trump's Attorney General. The Justice Department's motto, Qui pro domino justitia sequitur, refers to an Attorney General who prosecutes on behalf of justice. Based on his record, his responses to questions over the past few weeks, I am not confident Senator Sessions would be such an Attorney General. I cannot support his nomination, and I will vote against it. Mr. President, I yield the floor and suggest the absence of a quorum.
The clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Alexander.
Senator from Vermont.
Thank you, Mr. President. Among other decisions, we have this.
Senator, we're in a quorum call.
Oh, I apologize. Mr. President, I ask consent to call the quorum get be dispensed with.
Without objection.
Mr. President, along with other things this week, we have to decide whether Senator Sessions, somebody many of us have known, worked with for years, I have certainly during all the time he's been in the Senate, is the right person to lead the Department of Justice. I've thought long and hard on it. I've said he's not. I'd like to share a few reasons why. In fact, the Trump administration itself underscored what's at stake with this nomination. When the administration accused acting Attorney General Sally Yates of having betrayed the Department of Justice, exposed a view of the Justice Department that's disturbing and dangerous. To claim that Ms. Yates betrayed the department by refusing to defend the president's illegal and actually shameful executive order, you have to believe the Attorney General's office, your job is to defend the president at all costs, and that's wrong. I'll give you, and I think Senator Sessions knows that. When Sally Yates was before the Judiciary Committee for confirmation and testifying under oath, Senator Sessions said before he could support her, he had to have ironclad commitment from her and words to that effect that she would be willing to stand up to the President of the United States. And if the President was going to take a position that she thought was wrong or felt was wrong, that she'd stand up and say so. Well, perhaps she was remembering the commitment she made to Senator Sessions, and that's exactly what she did. And many around Senator Sessions felt that was, she never should have stood up to President Trump, should stand up to President Obama, but not President Trump. And within his first 2 weeks, the current administration found itself rebuked in numerous federal courts around the country. Actually, its extreme agenda casts a shadow over all of the president's nominees. This is an administration. It was even criticized yesterday by a very conservative Republican, John Yoo, in a New York Times op-ed titled, Executive Power Run Amok. You know there's a problem when the same man who twisted the law in order to greenlight torture thinks you have gone too far. The president seems to have a penchant for going too far. During the campaign, he promised, and this was said this number of times, it's carried by coverage in the press, he promised he would implement a Muslim ban. Actually stood there before the cameras and said that. As president, he then signed an executive order that barred immigration from certain Muslim-majority countries, but created exceptions that gave preference to members of minority religions in those countries, that is, non-Muslims. He even spoke to a Christian press organization and said he'd protect the Christians. Well, that's nothing more than a Muslim ban by another name. My parents and grandparents fought religious biases in this country. I've always felt one of the greatness of this country is when we said there'd be no religious bias, we'd actually stand up for the First Amendment. Remember, the First Amendment says you can practice any religion you want or none if you want. And it gives you freedom of speech. Now, if you have a country and a government that protects your right to practice any religion you want and protects your right of free speech, then that same government is protecting diversity. And if you have diversity, it's very easy to have a democracy. And when a federal judge in Washington State temporarily blocked this order, President Trump did not express respectful disagreement, as every president I've ever known, Republican or Democratic, would. He took to Twitter, like a teenage kid, to attack the judge's legitimacy, labeling him a so-called judge. President Trump then attempted to blame this judge, who incidentally was nominated by a Republican president and confirmed by a Republican-led Senate, for any future terrorist attack in this country. The president's words are beyond outrageous. It's almost like he wants to precipitate a constitutional crisis. And that's why the question of who should be our next attorney general is so critical. This is a president who must have an attorney general who's willing to stand up and say no if they're going beyond the law. Now, Sally Yates knew that. She proved that by telling the president this travel plan was indefensible under the law. But I've reviewed Senator Sessions' long record. I've reviewed his response to many questions. I'm not convinced that he is capable of telling the president no. Under oath, Senator Sessions denied that he was involved in creating the Muslim ban executive order. Well, I'll take him at his word. But Senator Sessions' views on this issue are well known to members of the Senate Judiciary Committee. In 2015, I offered a simple resolution to the committee. It expressed the sense of the Senate that the United States must not bar individuals from entering into the United States based on their religion. Very simple resolution. Every Democrat, mostly Republicans, including the Republican chairman, Senator Grassley, voted in support of my resolution. The committee recognized that imposing a religious test for those who seek to enter this country violates our most cherished values. But Senator Sessions broke away from the majority of his Republican colleagues. He strongly opposed the resolution. I found that deeply concerning in 2015 when he was a member of the committee. I find that even more disturbing now that he seeks to be our nation's top enforcement official. We need an attorney general who will stand in the way of religious discrimination, not one who endorses it. So today I'm going to introduce a very similar resolution. It reaffirms that no one should be blocked from entering the United States because of their nationality or their religion. I invite Senator Sessions, I invite all senators to co-sponsor this resolution. He's still taking an active role in the Senate, including voting on controversial cabinet nominees for President Trump. If he co-sponsored it, it helped to reassure Americans that he stands against religious discrimination and religious tests. But my concerns about whether Senator Sessions would be willing to tell President Trump no extend well beyond religious tests. In fact, in his testimony before the Judiciary Committee, both Republicans and Democrats, he did not demonstrate to the Judiciary Committee that he'd be willing to tell the president no on any issue, no matter how objectionable. Take, for example, the president's many conflicts of interest. Senator Sessions has refused to acknowledge there's a conflict of interest for a president to have a personal financial stake in the policies pursued by his administration. Actually, that's the definition 101 of a conflict of interest. Presidents should not personally profit from their decisions. And his answer is particularly troubling because I know that he knows the right answer. Senator Sessions told Senator Feinstein at his hearing, I own no individual stocks because I want to be sure I don't have conflicts of interest. He added, I want to adhere to high standards. Well, I appreciate that. But Senator Sessions, and I would assume Attorney General Sessions, would refuse to hold the president to any standards at all. In fact, his willful blindness extends even to the Russian interference in our democracy. In response to questions of the intelligence community's report on Russian interference, intelligence community that found without a doubt that we had Russian influence in our democracy, he responded by saying, I have not reviewed the report, but I have no reason not to accept the intelligence community's conclusions as contained in the report. If he hasn't read the report on something as critical as this, I suspect he's one of very few senators who hasn't. I asked him whether the activities described in the report are illegal. Are they a threat to our democratic process? For anyone other than President Trump, that's not a difficult question. Reading the report, the answer should be an obvious yes. But Senator Sessions refused to answer. If Senator Sessions is not willing even to acknowledge facts that might make President Trump uncomfortable, how can we believe that Attorney General Sessions would ever say no to President Trump? There's absolutely nothing in Senator Sessions' testimony before the Judiciary Committee that gives me confidence to be willing to stand up to the president. He's demonstrated only blind allegiance. This is a president that started citing what I guess the White House now calls alternative facts to deny his small crowd size at the inauguration. But he's now citing alternative facts to excuse murders and assassinations by Putin's regime. That should alarm us all. Shouldn't make any difference what party we belong to. As Americans, that should alarm us. Later tonight, I'll describe my concerns with Senator Sessions' record on civil rights issues. But I have one concern that's made much worse given Senator Sessions' lack of independence from President Trump. I'm particularly worried if confirmed, Senator Sessions will fail to protect Americans' constitutional right to vote. Nothing's more sacred in our democracy than the right to vote. But Senator Sessions declared it, quote, a good day for the South, close quote, not for the country, but for the South, when the Shelby County decision was handed down, which effectively gutted the Voting Rights Act, something that virtually every Republican and Democrat in both the House and the Senate voted for that President Bush signed into law. In fact, that Senator Sessions voted to reauthorize the Voting Rights Act in 2006 doesn't give me much comfort when immediately after that unanimous vote, he turned around and argued, notwithstanding his vote, it's unconstitutional. And you can't view this record on this issue in isolation, because if he's nominated and confirmed to be President Trump's Attorney General, well, we know the president has his own views on voting in America. Several Republicans, like the Speaker of the House, Speaker Ryan, our own colleague, Senator Graham, have rightly condemned President Trump's wild conspiracy theory. There's a conspiracy that brought about millions of illegal votes, costing him the popular vote, which he lost by nearly 3 million votes. And I fear that continuing this dangerous falsehood is going to be used to justify further attacks on the hard-won right to vote for racial minorities, students, poor, and elderly citizens. But what bothers me the most is Senator Sessions again refused to acknowledge a fundamental and plainly visible fact. The president's flat out wrong. There are only 3 million illegal votes cast. Senator Sessions responded to me. He doesn't know what data the president might have relied on. Well, the rest of us know there is no such data. But Senator Sessions refuses to admit as much. So his close ties to President Trump, the important role he's played in formulating President Trump's agenda, raise important questions about his impartiality and matters involving the president. I asked him several times, what's a scenario in which he'd recuse himself, given clear conflicts of interest? But he brushed those questions off. He claimed he was merely a supporter of the president during the campaign. Well, that'd be fine, but I think Senator Sessions is selling himself short. He was widely reported to be a central figure in the Trump campaign. Key figure in the Trump campaign, Steve Bannon, calling the president's clearinghouse for policy and philosophy. Now, that relationship appears to fly in the face of the Justice Department's recusal standards. Department standards mandate recusal when the attorney has a close identification with an elected official arising from service as a principal advisor thereto or principal officer thereof. I asked Senator Sessions the obvious question, whether that language would apply to his relationship to President Trump. He could answer yes or no, but he refused to say one way or the other. The Justice Department has to be independent because it's the chief law enforcement department in our government. But I worry about the independence in this administration. I've already seen that if you say no to the president, there goes your job. Now, more than ever, we need an attorney general who's willing to pay that cost for the good of the country. For the good of the country. Country outweighs any partisan interest in a particular office holder or a particular president. And I'm not convinced that kind of independence describes Senator Sessions. He's not demonstrated the independence that he used to demand of nominees. David Frum, a former speechwriter for President George W. Bush, recently wrote an article in The Atlantic addressing whether someone should accept an invitation to serve in the Trump administration, given the real risk that maybe tremendous pressure to do the wrong thing. The very first thing to consider, said the former Bush speechwriter, is how sure are you that you indeed would say no? And then humbly consider the second troubling question. If the Trump administration were as convinced as you are that you would do the right thing, would they have asked you in the first place? In the case of the nominee before us, Trump administration's clearinghouse for policy and philosophy, as Mr. Bannon calls him, I fear the answer to these questions is clear as they're troubling. That's why I'm going to be voting against this nominee. You know, for later. know, it's ironic, Mr. President. We're considering the nomination of Senator Sessions. So I said a position in which he's going to be responsible for defending the fundamental rights and liberties of the American people, all of us, whether you're supporters during the last campaign of President Trump or of Secretary Hillary Clinton. But even though Senator Sessions is supposed to defend our fundamental rights, we see President Trump continuing to praise Russian President Vladimir Putin, who has repeatedly demonstrated his disdain for freedom of speech, of association, of due process, of the rule of law. In less than a week, the president's attacked a federal judge for performing his constitutional duty. He's called unfavorable polls fake. He's continued to discredit as dishonest any media that dares to criticize him. His spokesperson, Sean Spicer, echoes these sentiments. They sound remarkably like one would expect to hear from Vladimir Putin. In fact, President Trump has done this while reiterating his support of torture and his admiration of Putin. Remember, Putin's critics, journalists, and others continue to turn up dead. Putin has stolen tens of billions of dollars or taken them in bribes from oil and gas and other industries. President Trump seems unaware of this, or is unconcerned about it, even though everybody knows about it. It's hard to avoid the conclusion after repeatedly lauding Putin's leadership. President Trump is now attempting to emulate Putin's efforts to spread misinformation, chastise his critics, intimidate those responsible for opposing the law, is assaults on anyone he perceives to be standing in his way, including a federal judge nominated by President George W. Bush, is even worse. His routine expressions of contempt for political norms that seem to be coming straight out of Stephen Bannon's playbook. And what is so bizarre and disturbing about this, not only has the president expressed little, if any, concern that every U.S. intelligence agency, every U.S. intelligence agency believes that Russia sought to influence and quite possibly did influence the presidential election, and Putin himself was involved. And Senator Sessions, who actively campaigned for the president, refused to recuse himself from decisions related to Russia's cyber attacks. Can anyone imagine the Republican leadership would be saying if the table was turned, they'd try to shut down the government to be held a new election? Failing that, they'd demand an independent commission be established to investigate the Russian hacking. They insist the nominee for Attorney General pledged to recuse himself. Well, along with Senator Durbin and others, I've called for such an independent commission outside of the Congress. But the Republican leaders have summarily rejected it. It's cynical politics at its worst. It puts partisanship over the integrity of our elections. President Trump and Senator Sessions both speak about the importance of law and order. President Trump and Vladimir Putin seem to agree about what those words mean. Senator Sessions has said nothing to suggest that he disagrees, even though the Republican leadership recognizes, the congressional Republican leadership recognizes Putin as a dangerous thug who tramples on the rule of law. Why our president keeps praising this man who assassinates his critics, who has killed people who criticize him in the media, who has stolen so much money, taken so many bribes, he's become one of the wealthiest people in the world. Not a person to praise. Don't emulate him. We have a lot of leaders. We have a lot of leaders in our own country, both Republicans and Democrats, we can praise, but not Vladimir Putin. I think we have to be careful, have to care about the integrity of our democracy, about due process, the rule of law, about the constitutional checks and balances that distinguish this country from autocracies like Russia. And we should expect the nominee for Attorney General to demonstrate he will defend these principles, to not remain silent when they're attacked, even if the person attacking them is the President of the United States. President, I see the distinguished senior senator from Connecticut on the floor, and I will yield the floor. Balance of my time.
Mr. President.
Senator from Connecticut.
Thank you, Mr. President. I am honored to follow my distinguished colleague from Vermont, who has led the Judiciary Committee with such vision and courage over so many years, and whom I respect as a former prosecutor, as I am, as well as a litigator and a conscience of the Senate. I am deeply concerned that our nation is careening toward a constitutional crisis, a legal nightmare that will test the independence of the judiciary and require the utmost resolve and integrity from everyone involved in the justice system and from the Congress, because only the Congress may provide the kind of check on the ongoing assault against our court system. President Trump repeatedly has tried to put himself above the law, moving in just a few weeks from scorning conflict of interest and disclosure principles to promulgating destructive, discriminatory executive orders and openly attacking the judiciary. His personal invective and insults are unprecedented for the President of the United States against the judiciary. Without respect for the rule of law and the court system, democracy fails. And no cabinet member has more responsibility to ensure that the justice system is given this necessary respect and trust than the Attorney General of the United States. The sweeping authority in this position impacts the lives and livelihoods of everyday Americans, implicating everything from our immigration system to law enforcement to civil rights to national security, capital punishment, sentencing, the United States Supreme Court. This job is one I know well. Like some of my colleagues, I served as the United States Attorney in the Department of Justice, the Chief Federal Prosecutor for Connecticut for several years, reporting to the United States Attorney General. And then for several years afterward as a private litigator, and then for 20 years as Attorney General of the state of Connecticut. I fought alongside and sometimes against the United States Attorney General and the armies of lawyers at his disposal. In fact, the Attorney General commands thousands of lawyers who embody his power to speak on behalf of the United States. His job is to protect the public from criminal offenders and to convict the guilty, but also to protect the innocent who may be wrongly accused and to assure that justice is done. In fact, as Justice Jackson said about the role of United States Attorney General, which he filled, he is to seek justice, not just win cases. I know how powerful this position can be and how crucial the Attorney General is, not as the appointee of a politician, but as a servant of justice. In discharging this sacred obligation, the Attorney General must always remain independent, not just in reality, but in appearance. His decisions must supersede partisan politics. In most cases, there is, in fact, no recourse from his decision without political interference, which would be improper. He is not just another government lawyer. He's not just another cabinet position. He is the nation's lawyer. He's the people's lawyer. He must be the nation's legal conscience. This job requires a singular level of intellect and integrity and a nonpartisan but passionate devotion to the rule of law. Over the past week, as our nation's courts did their job and sorted through the implications of the president's hasty, ill-conceived, and illegal executive orders, President Trump called into question the very integrity of our judicial system. Not only did he label United States District Court Judge Robart a, quote, so-called judge, end quote, but he also suggested that the American people should blame him and our, quote, court system, end quote, if something should happen as a result of the court blocking his executive order. This anticipatory blame, the bluster and bullying, are inappropriate, unpresidential, and I believe they threaten harm to our democracy as well as the judicial system. The comments were deeply disturbing to all of us who believe in the integrity of the judicial system, including the American Bar Association, that said through Linda Klein, its president, quote, personal attacks on judges are attacks on our Constitution, and, quote, the independence of the judiciary is not up for negotiation. Independence from party politics, independence from Congress, and independence from the President of the United States himself, end quote. Ms. Klein called upon all lawyers to defend the rule of law in light of these attacks on the Constitution, and I echo this call proudly today. The importance of it cannot be overstated. Nowhere is that job more significant than with the Department of Justice and the Attorney General of the United States as head of that department. That agency is tasked with seeking and achieving justice, not carrying out the president's agenda as a priority. That does not mean that lawyers at the Department of Justice, who are currently defending those orders in court, are acting improperly or wrongly. What it means is that the country needs an independent justice system staffed by people who are ready to stand up and speak out to a president whose orders may contravene constitutional law. And we saw this principle in action last week. We saw what it really means to serve at the Department of Justice and represent not the president, but the American people, the Constitution, and the rule of law. Former acting Attorney General and Deputy Attorney General Sally Yates took a stand based on moral and legal principle, and I want to thank Ms. Yates for her courage and strength in that action. Holding herself to the highest traditions of the Department of Justice, Ms. Yates said that in her judgment, these orders cannot be defended, that the rule of law and morality is more important than the politics of the moment and the impulsive edicts of a ruler who apparently fails to uphold the law. And her actions raise the question of whether the next Attorney General will have the same courage and strength. Ms. Yates demonstrated genuine grit and grace in standing strong for the rule of law, and her actions are in the proud, long tradition of the department, not since Watergate. Has an attorney general or acting attorney general been fired for acting in accordance with the with their conscience and the rule of law? Unfortunately, President Trump threatens to return us to that era. He has made his intentions clear. The Department of Justice will not be an independent authority acting on behalf of the American people. Instead, it will be another enabler of the president's ongoing efforts to substitute his whims and wishes for legal and ethical responsibility. I believe the president's orders are misguided and illegal. The courts will rule in coming hours and days. They are wrong, his orders, in no small part because they threaten to take away one of the primary reasons why ours is the greatest country in the history of the world, the country that my father, a refugee from Nazi Germany, sought in 1935. He arrived here at 17 years old with not much more than the shirt on his back, speaking